The purpose of this demo is to show you how to access the Java API and some basics of navigating it for your own program development purposes. Remember, we said that the Java API was the ultimate authority on how to create and use new objects of any class in Java. So it really behooves us to know our way around it, at least in some simple sense. Anything you need to know about any class in Java, you'll find documented in the Java API. So for starters, how do we access the Java API? Well, several ways to do this were given in the lecture materials for this week, but I think the easiest way in most circumstances when you're developing code is simply to get to it from the jGRASP IDE itself. So all you do is go here to the Help menu where you see Nothing Related. This is because you actually have to have a file open to get to the API. So we could even do some new Java file or just have any file open. This one is my template. And now if we go back to the Help menu, we'll see this additional entry for the Java API. Simply click this, and here's the Java API. You might have Java 8 installed. I've got Java 7 at the moment, but what we're talking about is relevant to either version. Okay, so now we've got the Java API open. What's in there? Well, for starters, notice that this is a web page pointing to the official Oracle documentation, and basically this is just a huge list of all the available Java classes, 2,000 or so. You can take a look through here if you're curious, and all of the available packages. And so here's a scrollable list of packages in the upper left. For every class, it will present that class's API. So I'm going to just click on a class at random, and here is the class's API, which is its constructors and all of its available methods. And this is really huge. When I started programming a couple decades ago, language documentation was contained in manuals, which took up shelves and shelves of space in a computer room. When I first started programming with Java, I thought I'd died and gone to heaven because all this stuff was suddenly available online. But this entire document is also an example of what can be automatically generated using the Java doc style of comments that we've seen. So as a first example, let's look at a class that we've already seen. Let's take the random class. Suppose we wanted to use this in a program, but we couldn't remember how to use it or what its package address was so that we could import it. Well, what we can do, I'll scroll up here a little bit. Let's go back to the alphabetical list of classes, and let's scroll down and find the random class, which is right there. So I'll click on it. And here's the API for the random class. So notice that we've got the package address of random. So if we want to use it, we have to import java.util.random. And notice that all classes in an API will ultimately be descended from this one ultimate ancestor class object, or java.lang.object. This has to do with the object-oriented programming idea of inheritance, or creating new classes from existing ones, which we won't get into in this course, but this is going to be covered in detail in CS13. But anyway, here's the API for random. There's a bunch of verbiage on the class. And if we scroll down, here are its constructors. And this is the constructor that we've used. We specified an input value to start with. And then if we scroll down a little bit more, here are all the available methods that we can work with, along with their calling interfaces and return types. So for example, once we set up a random object, we wanted to return the next int, which returns a random int value. If we click on any method in this API, it'll take us down to a little more detail on that method. And we said that random generated pseudo-random numbers. Well, here are some notes on the algorithm that is used to do that. So if you're interested, you can read up on that. But anyway, this is the kind of stuff that's contained in an API for any class. Suppose that we did know the package address of some class. Suppose that we knew that we were wanting to work with java.util.random. Let's just kind of scatter this up a little bit. If we want to find the same random class using its package address, we can go to this list of packages, and we said it was in java.util. So here's the java.util package. Here are all the classes appearing in that package, and lo and behold, one of them is random. So if we click on that, we get back to the same place by another means. As I just alluded to, we can also locate classes on a package-by-package basis. So by extension, we can also take a look at what's inside a particular package. So for example, let's go back to the java.util package, give ourselves a little room here, and here are all the classes that are part of java.util. So we just took a look at random. Here's another one that's part of that package, scanner. So here's the API for the scanner class, and so forth and so on. Here's all the stuff that's part of the util class. What about java.lang? That's another package we've worked with. That's a standard one that we get for free without having to import. But here are a bunch of classes that are part of java.lang. And we see familiar with ones like string. So here's the API for the string class. And notice that there are a lot more capabilities than we even touched on in our brief treatment of the string class. Next, let's take a look at another class we're familiar with, and that's the math class, which is also in the java.lang package. So we'll click on that, and we'll scroll down a little bit through its API, and we can see that there are many, many other methods available that we didn't even get to touch upon. We just kind of skimmed the surface. But you can see things for example, arc cosines, arc trig functions, exponents, various types of logarithms, min and max, and many, many others, sines, square roots, tangents, and so forth. One thing we said was that the methods of the math class were all static methods. Well, here's the static keyword we're talking about. And one thing that confused me at first was that this static doesn't refer to the type of the output. For example, this result is not a static double. This static is part of the interface. So for example, static long round. This is all part of the interface. And it's just saying that the round method is called statically, as is the case for all of the math methods. Scrolling back up a little bit, if we take a look at the abs method, we can see that there are multiple overloaded forms. This just tells us that we can call the absolute value function with doubles, floats, ints, or longs, and the output type will match the corresponding type of the input. So this is an example of overloading in an API. Finally, we should note that the Java API documents all of the classes that are provided by Java. But what do we do for external classes which are user-created or perhaps third-party provided? So for example, let's close the Java API down and go to something like CS12Date, which I provided for use in this class. Fortunately, as I was writing it, I documented this class using javadoc comments such as these. And what this means is that we can automatically create our own documentation. So let's say we opened up this file in jGRASP. We can click this little book icon for show and generate documentation. And what we'll get is some automatically created javadoc style documentation for our class. This is in the same format as for the other classes we've seen. Here are the instance variables, followed by the constructors for CS12Date, and then all of the things that you can do with a CS12Date object. If you click on one of these, you'll drill down to more details on that particular method. The only thing I want to point out here is that you will see some methods here which are marked as private. And these are the ones which you aren't able to use as part of the CS12Date API. These are intended to be private for internal use only as helper methods. But all of these other ones you will find in the provided CS12Date API from a previous week's lecture materials. So if you want another way of getting at the documentation for this class, you can simply load it up in jGRASP and click that documentation icon. Okay, I hope all of this has provided you with a short introduction to the Java API. Don't hesitate to pull it up and peruse through it when you're trying to write your programs. As a parting thought, here's a simple experiment you can try on your own. Open up one of your own files in jGRASP, click on this documentation icon, see what kind of documentation it generates. Give it a shot.